So the first question that I do have about Laura is, who was Laura for you?
She was my teacher, and I have so much respect when I say that word. She was my teacher. She taught me, and she taught me, not only did she well teach me, but she, in her teaching, she gave me the confidence that I could be taught and that I could be taught her work. And that's what I wish a teacher to be for me. She gave me a lot of confidence as she spread and shared her knowledge with me. So she was my teacher.
So another question is, how did you experience Laura?
Well, I mean, my first story, when I had to wait to study with Laura until I finished my 4 years at Gestalt Associates for psychotherapy, because I didn't think I was ready, which is a silly thing, but she lived a block away from me. So I used to see her in the health food store. And when I saw her, I'd grab onto a stranger and say, that's Laura Perls. She's a living legend. That's everything. Who is that? Finally, when I graduated, I came to see her. And I was so anxious. I said, Laura, I'm so anxious. I don't know if I can talk. She said, well, can you sing? So I sang my whole first session with Laura. And when she was ill, before she went back to Germany to die, she was in the hospital. I came to visit her and she said, what's the news of the day? And I said, oh, I don't think I can really say the news of the day. And she said, can you dance it? And I did. Laura gave me permission to use myself. Like she said, she always would say, and she has written, Gestalt therapy is Gestalt therapists, that we all work from our backgrounds. And when I was first working at the Gestalt Associates for psychotherapy, which is very different now, where I teach now, we had to tape sessions with our patients. We had clinic patients. And I had a patient on the floor, and I was sitting next to him. And my supervisor said, you had a patient on the floor? So it was a big, like, you shouldn't do that. She has since apologized over and over for that, but that was many years ago in the early 80s. And when I got to Laura, one of the first things I saw was she asked one of the people in the group to be on the floor. And then because she could not get down and up so easily, she asked me to work with him. So it was really supporting that thought of use your background, use whoever you are. That's what you draw from.
And how would you say that her work has influenced you as a person or in your own
Well, I think before I went to study with her, I saw Laura as a keynote speaker in the Gestalt Center of Long Island, which is now defunct. But and she had someone stand and in his upright posture, and then bend his knees, and then push away the floor, bend his knees and push away the floor to feel himself. And at the time, I was a student of Bonnie Bainbridge Cohen, and I was looking at how Bonnie helped us find the earth by pushing away from it. And I thought, oh, that's a push pattern. She's using a push pattern, and I had a name for it. So when I got to Laura and she talked about the supports for contacting, which is anything that has been assimilated by the organism and is used as support for the next contacting. And the most primary support, she talked about coordinated movements. And I thought, these are the movements I've been working with for years. So I had a way to talk about what I was doing and integrate it more clearly into the theory of Gestalt. So that was really crucial to me in my development.
Another question is how Laura influenced you as a person.
It was something that Eric Werthmann, who was also in my training group program, said when Laura was dying. He said, and as she got older, I was with her for 4 years, as she got older, she would start to go off a little bit in group. And Eric said, Laura taught us how to die and how to let go slowly and slowly. And I think that's true, especially when she actually was in the process of dying. And I came to the hospital and we came to visit her at home. We were learning how to say goodbye and how she was saying goodbye. And I don't think I really have words for that. I know once when I was walking around Central Park with her and she was still taking that walk around the reservoir, she said, and it was true, she said, every time I walk, I wonder if this will be my last spring.
Ooh.
And it was. And I never forgot that. And I wish I had been able to share more with her about how I felt toward her. But again, I was too shy to come forward. She knew I loved her.
Mm-hmm.
And I, at least I hope she knew that. I'm sure she knew that. And I didn't really know that she loved me until somebody else in the group after she died said, Laura really loved you. And I said, she did? How do you know that? Of course, you could feel it. And I thought, I would not have made that assumption, but I must have on some level felt it. When she was finally, you know, the last, before she went back to Germany, I was taking her for a ride in her wheelchair in the park. And I was helping strap her in and blah, blah. And my mother had been in a wheelchair. So it was like I was doing something very familiar and that I knew that I could do with her, take her around and about and make her feel safe.
Mm-hmm.
So that was, those were all the moments that I remember with Laura.
Mm-hmm.
She was always sensitive. In the group, she would come to the group and wait. Laura taught me to wait. And you know, I can wait. So that when you're with someone, you wait and wait until whatever is emerging. And we would wait and sweat would pour down our faces as we were waiting in anxiety in the group. And then a beginning would happen. She did, as we worked in the group, it was primarily, you know, working person to person, one person at a time. And then the group would come in and also chime after, but it was Laura who did most of the work. And I shared many a dream with Laura.
Okay.
Who you could see as she worked, she was a wonderful psychoanalyst and Gestalt therapist, but you could see that foundation, especially in working with dreams.
Did you want to share a particular piece of her work that you remember, either yours or something that you witnessed?
Well, I remember she was working with someone in the group who we all loved, and he had HIV, he had AIDS at that point, and he also had a melanoma, so he was, and it was not good. So he was going to die of one thing or the other. And just how she didn't get up and move around much, but she came up to him, walked toward him slowly, and grabbed onto his hand. And I remember that moment of her using herself. And I only remember clearly one dream I had worked on where I had dreamt about Madonna. And of course she had me be Madonna in the group and dance around and priss around. But other than that, I can't really remember. but it was a great opportunity and I learned a lot and felt very privileged to be there. Also, it was a wonderful group. And that's how I met Dan Bloom.
Okay.
In the group, and he had green sneakers and he was introducing himself, and we all came around saying something, and I said, I feel like you're going to give me a lot of trouble. And that was psychic.
said and done, right?
That was so true. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So do you think that Laura really had a sense of the transcendence of her work and the work of Gestalt?
I'm sure she did. Mm-hmm. I'm sure she did. She knew who she was and what she had done. And it was interesting that as difficult as Fritz was in her life, especially the last years, you walked in the door and there was a picture of Fritz. And she was very respectful about him, towards him. But she knew her position and what she had done. And was clear about that. She didn't talk a lot about theory. I can't say she was really an avid theorist, but she was a brilliant practitioner and really taught us how to practice. As a matter of fact, once we were talking about theory and we were talking about Perls, Heffernan, and Goodman, the book, and we referred to it as the Bible, and she said, it's only a book. So... Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think she knew who she was and what she had done, what she had created. She was the president of the New York Institute for 1,000 years, and she commanded that institute. Mm-hmm. She really could, so did she know who she was? Yeah, sure. She commanded that institute. Mm-hmm. And she would, I remember she would sit there and talk about, you know, before there was psychology, there was literature. And she'd talk about novels often. She could remember, you know, I've read Anna Karenina several times, but the way she remembered it was as if she never forgot. So she had a very classical upbringing, of course, in Germany and at the time. And was a real intellect and brought that to her.
So what else am I missing? What else would you say about Laura, about how she's stayed with you or your experiences with her?
I'm going to go back to this waiting. Mm-hmm. Because it gives me a chance to really feel myself with the other person and allow the other person, myself, to come forward. And so when I think of Laura or watch her work, her patience, so I think it was one of her first experiences working with patients, and it was in a mental hospital, and a patient walks in, sits down, says nothing. Laura says nothing. Patient leaves. Next session. Patient walks in, sits down, says nothing. Laura says nothing. Patient leaves. Third session. Same thing. Patient leaves. Fourth session. Patient sits down, says, thank you for waiting. Did I ever forget that story? The necessity of being interested in what is not easily obvious, but is there. Mm-hmm. I also worked with Laura when she was older, in her 80s. So I'm sure it was a different Laura than when she was in her 50s, or in her 60s, or even her 70s. And I'm not sure how different. It would be interesting for you to see in an interview who was with Laura early on.
Yeah, but I know it's late to be reaching out to people who knew her. It's historically late, but there is definitely there's still a sense of some threads. So
I'm so glad that you're doing this. And what about you imagines that you're attracted to the people who work with Laura? What is
it? It's just, I think it's more the sense of being a support. And everybody does this. Everybody does that gesture. And I'm just like, I've noticed that. Yeah. And it, just talking about being a support and being there when they refer to her in particular, and just her way of being there. I'm interested in. I'm interested in a person who can leave that experience and that impression in people across the world 30 years later. It's like, oh.
As much support as necessary, as little as possible, because I want to make that very clear. It's not that she came, she walked, it was unusual to have her walk over and do that. I do remember something now, Laura, that I had broken up with a boyfriend. I was in my 30s, I guess, and it was upsetting, and someone, Ruth, handed me a pillow and said, "Bang the pillow." And Laura said, "That's cathartic, not relational." You may put that in here. Because when I first started in the 70s as a patient of Gestalt therapy, we were whacking everything. I remember my therapist had me whack my mother, who was in a wheelchair, bad. So.
Yeah, that's not so relational.
No, and it's catharsis has its limits. I mean, do something like that and then you feel guilty for 10 years after. So it wasn't very useful, but little things like that come up to me. But I do want to say, as much support as necessary. She let you sit there and struggle on your own with something. I also learned a lot about being aware of gesture with her, because a friend of mine in the group would gesture like this. Put the screen down. And she said, "You start with a bang and end with a whimper." And it was so true. I mean, it wasn't just this gesture. She was looking at the whole of him. And I thought, okay, let's get some ideas about gesturing. And so I think all of us have developed from there in understanding. The piece I added, she said that contacting was the coordinating of one part of the body in relation to the other. And I added one part of the body in relation to the other and the environment. And that was the complexity of coordination. But she started me off with that, to look at coordinated movements in that way. So I just, you know, when you stand on the shoulders of someone who is so brilliant and so smart, that's a real guide as to what comes next. I think it was Merleau-Ponty who said that, I'm gonna botch it, but the richness of a theory is not what the theorist has said, but what is left to say. And Laura left a lot in her brilliance, left a lot to say. And so I keep digging into that. She had a way of making the body important, and at that time, not yet precisely and phenomenologically describing what she was doing. That's something left to say. I'm seeing myself in her apartment, which was wonderful. And also sitting there in the living room where my mentor, Richard Kitzler, had sat for years, and where all of them sat, and Goodman and Fritz, and creating and putting together, and Isidore putting together Gestalt theory and practice. So it was an honor to be there.
Well, thank you.